Good morning, everyone. In fact, in the last session, we discussed about the basics of multimedia networking and its applications. Of course, as I mentioned to you, the multimedia networking is one of the very basic technology where we could able to transmit both the real-time applications like the audio and video. In fact, when it comes to the audio and video, it is very challenging for us to make that transmission because these are called real-time transmissions. And hence, we need to be very, very careful on that part. Now we'll move on to another important segment in this. That's called as the video streaming. Video streaming. Just a minute. Yeah, it is called a stored video streaming. I think you might have heard about the videos that have been stored in the server and then delivered to the customer. The other category is live video streaming. Watching cricket match in live is the best example for that. However, the stored video streaming is a case where the video has been already recorded and it is stored in the server. From the server, it is being downloaded by the user and it is played back in the user's desktop or any gadget. In this streamed video storage, the best examples are YouTube, Netflix, and other categories, wherein we will have many videos that are stored and that are supposed to be played by the user. So the user will be frequently accessing the same video or different videos, but every time it is being streamed from the server and it is downloaded and played back at the user point. So now we look at the things with this stored video. There are three basic technologies or categories that are being used here. One is the UDP, the other one is HTTP. Hypertext Transfer Protocol, and the third one is the Adaptive HTTP. These are the three techniques that are possible with the streaming of the stored video. As I mentioned to you earlier, the UDP is User Datagram Protocol, which is more oftenly called as the non-reliable protocol at the transport layer. However, this will help us in transmitting the data at a very faster rate. Here, as in case of TCP, there won't be a connection establishment and then making the data transfer. Rather, the data transfer will be made directly. And hence, the faster delivery of the packet is taken care in the transport layer. HTTP is a hypertext transfer protocol, which is always used the URL to access and then it will be connected. So any server connected by the user will be using this hypertext transfer protocol through the web browsers. This is one of the very, very popular and useful protocol that has been used. Along with that one, there is an improvisation over that made for the video transmission, and that is called Adaptive HTTP, and which we will discuss later. Let us go ahead with the streaming of the stored video. You can see this. This is the basic video that has been recorded in the server. You can see at this point each step will show the storage of each frame. Okay, and these frames are stored with respect to the time. Okay, so and hence the storage takes in a linear manner. You can observe this, it is a linear manner. So the storage is done like that, and this stored video will be streamed to the customer. When the client make a request, it is expected that this stored video is transmitted in the same pattern, and as it is transmitted in the same pattern, it is expected that at the receiver point, he will playback, okay, playback the same video in the same speed, that is 30 frames per second. Each frame will take 1 second to play, okay, 1/30th of a second. So this is how exactly the playback is planned. This is an ideal case. You can see that we have not considered any issues here, like the network is able to transmit the data or the video at the rate it had been recorded, and hence the same speed it is being delivered. So you can see this is the network delay between the transmission and the receiver, and this delay remains to be constant. You can see for any frame at different level, at this level, so this has got the difference, and hence if the delay in the transmission is fixed, that is it is constant, and playback is smooth, and it will be played back in a smooth manner to the user. But in a practical scenario, that is not the point that happens. Okay, so here what can be observed by you is by the time it is being transmitted, this particular frame, okay, so the receiver is, or the user is playing the older frame. Okay, the reason is very simple. It is because of the network delay. Okay, so by the time the server is rendering the 9th or 8th frame, the user is playing the first or second frame. So that is happening because of the network delay. So this network delay is expected to be constant, but it will not be constant on all the time. Okay, so that is the major concern in the network system, and hence we will see the different possibilities that can happen with the video streaming in the network. So there are some challenges that we will discuss in this. Okay, there is a continuous playout of the video is expected here. The playback must match with the original timing, but most of the time that is not the practical case, whereas there will be variation in the delay, and this variation in the delay is called as jitter. Okay, so the meaning of this jitter is that once the frame is transmitted, so few of the packets will receive with the 5 millisecond delay, another few will receive by the receiver at 10 millisecond, further 5 may be delivered at 8 millisecond delay. Like this, the delay, if it varies from one packet to the another packet, we say there is a variation in the delay, the network delay, and hence it creates a jitter. Due to the jitter, the smooth playback is not possible at the receiving point. In order to make it smoother, we need the buffer, so that the buffer will maintain. Buffer means it is a small memory. Okay, so this memory will maintain the collected or received packets in and at the client point, and it will play back with the same rate, that is the constant rate. So without buffer, it is difficult as to achieve the constant or smooth playback. It is basically because of the jitter in the network. There are other challenges that are also expected in the video transmission. I think you must be knowing that while watching the video, we'll do so many other operations also. We may pause the video for some time, or we may not be interested to watch some segment of the video. We'll go for the fast forwarding. Sometimes we want to go back and see some portion of the video. We rewind it and watch from the earlier point, or otherwise, suddenly we may jump to the future frame. So that is the other part or the later part of the video. So these are different operations that are being done by the customer while watching the video. All these challenges are supposed to be taken care by your network system. So that's the reason video playing is the most challenging job in the network. Also, the video package that might be lost in the transmission. It is always happens because it all depends on the throughput of the network. We say that the throughput will be varying very oftenly, and hence there is a variation in the efficiency of the transmission. Out of 100 packets I have transmitted, it may reach 80 packets correctly. Another 20 are either failed or corrupted. So these are supposed to be retransmitted. Okay, so this is a basic problem in case of the network, regular network. And these challenges are supposed to be handled with the effective utilization of the buffer. So buffer plays a very, very important role in case of video streaming in order to overcome all these kind of challenges. Let us discuss the various technologies that will work, and we'll see in practical way how the jitter will make an effect. Here you can see that there is a part where the video is transmitted by the server at a constant rate. Okay, the constant bit rate video transmission is done by the server. This is the server side transmission. So, but when it is received by the receiver, the delays are varying from one packet to another packet. You can see that these delays are not constant here. One has received, the first packet is received with this delay. The third packet is received at this delay. Okay, it is faster here. Okay, in this phase. Again, it is further delayed here. More delay is happening here. More delay, less delay here. Okay, like this. And again, a bigger delay you can find in this. So likewise, the delay in every packet varies irregularly, and this leads to the jitter in the network. But however, this delay should not make any trouble for the playback of the video. What we expect at the client side is this video must have been played smoothly. So this is the expectation, and in order to achieve this expectation, we need to buffer the packets or the video frames. So how much to be buffered, and what level we have to do the buffering, and how the buffering is supposed to be handled, what are the technical challenges in it, and buffering will create a lot of other issues also. How all these are handled practically is the basic question. We will discuss that in the next part. You can see this, here is an illustration at the client side. Buffering and the playout is explained. The video server is rendering the video to the cloud. You can see this blue portion, we call it as cloud. From the cloud, it has been delivered to the customer. The filling rate to the buffer, the video bits filling rate is x of t. Okay. It is a variable one because we told that this filling rate varies because of the network delay and other issues. Now, the playout is always constant, you remember. So though the filling rate is varying, the but play out is always constant. Suppose I say it is playing out at the 5 megabits per second, and it is filling at the rate of 5 Mbps at some point, 6 Mbps at some point, and 3 Mbps at some other point. So these are the variations that happens, but these variations are consumed by the buffer. Okay, so buffer is filled by a portion of QT. QT says how much buffer is filled, and the size B says the total size of the buffer. If I say that 500 MB, this is the size of the buffer. Okay, out of which Q of T is filled here. So the moment you assume that if it is transmitting at 5 Mbps, the same is consumed by the receiver, and hence the playback of the video is at the same rate of the transmission. But when it becomes 6 Mbps, actually the required rate is 5 Mbps at the playback. So additional 1 MB will be stored in the buffer. Okay. In the next minute, it has dropped down to 3 Mbps. Okay. The moment it drops down to 3 Mbps, but however, the expectation at the receiver is 5 Mbps only, and hence the additional 2 Mbps is supported by the buffer, because it has been stocked some of the frames and that are being delivered here. So this is what exactly the mechanism of this buffer, and this buffer will try to manage the constant delivery of the packets to the receiver. Either I can say the packet or the frames. I think the same is explained. Initial fill buffer TP is indicated. The playout rate at the TP, buffer fill with an variation of X of T, and it is playout at the rate of R. Now we'll take a scenario where the different possibilities, how the buffer will act, and what could be the challenge even in using the buffer. You can see here, if this X value, that is filling rate, is faster than the receiving rate or the playout rate, then there won't be a problem. Or otherwise, let us take the first case. Here he said that the filling rate is lesser than the playout rate. So if that is the case, then what happens? There is a possibility that the data will go out of this buffer, and hence it will trying to maintain the constant rate at the receiving point and try to match the R value. Okay, so suppose it is 3 Mbps, but it is 5 Mbps, additional 2 Mbps is supported by the buffer. But how long it can support is the question. Till this buffer is exhausted. The moment it is exhausted, still the input is 3 and output is 5, then the output cannot reach 5. During that period, your play out will stop here. Okay, it is called as freezing of the video happens at your point. More oftenly we call, whenever we are trying to stream some video from YouTube or Netflix, if there is a round arrow is going on, then we assume that there is a streaming is happening, and hence the buffering is happening, we say. So this is because of this problem. Your play out rate is more than the fill out rate. So that's the reason it happens. Now the other possibility is the filling rate is higher than the play out rate. In this scenario, probably we can consider this as 7 MB is the transmission rate, filling rate, and 5 MB is the play out rate. In that case, X is greater than R, and the excess 2 MB is being stored in the buffer. So now the play out remains to be constant at 5 Mbps, and hence the excess is maintained in the buffer. So this will not make any problem. But however, there could be another problem. That is, if 7 Mbps continues to be transmitted for a longer period, the storage may exhaust here in the buffer. Okay. So due to the exhaust in the storage, what happens? A back pressure develops here. Back pressure means the buffer is full and the receiver cannot receive all the transmitted packets. And this intimation goes to the server, and either server will slow down or it will stop for a while. Okay. Either it will slow down or stops for a while, so that buffer should not be overflown. If it is overflown, it will lose some packets. Okay. So that is what exactly happens with this. And this is how exactly we manage the buffer. And I think you should be very clear about understanding the need of the buffer and how the buffer manages the constant flow rate at the output, so that the video can be played smoothly. Let us discuss on some of the technologies that are being adopted for this video transmission. As I mentioned to you earlier, one UDP is one basic protocol that is being used at the transport layer to make the transmission of the real-time applications like audio and video. In this video transmission, that is multimedia transmission, UDP stands for an user datagram protocol. It is named as user datagram protocol. The very nature of this protocol is that this will transmit all the received packets through any possible path, so that the packet should try to reach the destination at the earliest. So that is the idea in this, so that there is no fixed path for all the transmitted packets. Okay. And the other point is, the received packet on the receiver side, because of UDP, may be received in an in order. So they will not be in the proper order. Okay. The order of the packet received might be different. In that case, it is the receiver responsibility to reorder the packets and to play out. So that is the UDP. And whatever the technique that is being used in UDP, it is called as a best effort technique. So the meaning of best effort is it will be trying to transmit the packets in a best possible way. Okay. So that is why it is called as a best effort technique. Here the sending rate is equal to the encoding rate, and then there is possibility of constant play out at the receiving point. But as I mentioned you, UDP is a non-reliable protocol. It is basically called as a non-reliable protocol because of its very nature, and hence there is a loss of packet is possible. Even if there is a loss of packet, it won't make much problem. But if the transmission rate or speed is very, very slow compared to the receiving side, then there could be a possibility of freezing in the video play out. So when the transmission slows down because of the network delay, obviously the receiver will receive at a slower rate, and hence there cannot be a proper play out. So this can be overcome with a little the buffer. A small buffer will help for overcoming the problem of the jitter. Okay, so that's the advantage going for this. And very rarely it will leads to the problem of freezing, because here always it is trying to push the packets at the earliest to reach the destination. Then we can go through some of the issues. The error inquiry is done at the application level, and time permitting is also done. So that here basically what happens is error recovery is done by means of feedback. So the receiver will send a feedback saying that so and so packets have been missed, and hence it will be retransmitted. And in UDP, more oftenly, the retransmission is not encouraged. The reason for that is here it is a non-reliable communication, so that I am speaking now, if my video, if it is playing, where if I miss one word, okay, it will not make much difficulty you to understand what I am speaking. So loss of few packets will not make any big difference. But however, if the loss is remarkable, then the problem occurs. So you have to be very careful on that part. Right. So then the UDP will more oftenly run over the RTP. What is RTP? It is the real-time protocol, and hence it will support the UDP to make the transmission of the packets to the destination. But here there is one problem with UDP that is called the firewall. Most of the firewalls are configured such that it will block the UDP traffic. So because of that reason, sometimes it is not possible for us to make the transmission with respect to the UDP protocol. The few other problems are the playout is not always smooth due to the jitter, as I mentioned to you. And it requires RTSP, that is the real-time protocol. The other version, RTSP is used, stream protocol we say, real-time stream protocol. This is used for the purpose of control communication. Control communication means there might be a communication between the sender and receiver saying that the sender is transmitting continuously, but at the same time, receiver may pause his video for a while, and a back pressure develops that is to be communicated to the server. And also there are possibilities where the fast forward might be done by the user. That time the transmission speed has to increase by the server. That might be indicated to the server. All these such communications are called as control communication, and these communications are possible because of this protocol, real-time transport streaming protocol. This will increase the cost and also complexity. This is the second problem with the UDP. And the third problem, already I have told you, the firewall will block the UDP traffic, and hence it leads to so many other complexity. But otherwise, the overall what I suggest is, in practical scenario, mostly UDP is the best solution for the real-time applications like audio, video, or multimedia communications. Let us take up the second protocol, that is called HTTP protocol. HTTP stands for Hypertext Transfer Protocol. Already you might be aware of this protocol. It is basically work with respect to the URL. Okay. Whenever the client will make a request of a particular the server, the URL of the server is indicated, and it will make the request. And the request always goes by means of HTTP GET method. Okay, GET is a method that is being used by it. So this HTTP GET method will help in making the request to the server, and hence the server will be responding with the service to the client. In this, it will send the maximum possible rate through the TCP. Most of the time here we'll be using the TCP. As I told, TCP is a contemporary to UDP. In the means, either we can go for an UDP or TCP. The TCP reliable transmission, and hence the error recovery and error correction are all possible with the TCP. So here is a scenario again wherein a video file is being delivered. Here, the TCP will have two type of buffers. Three types of buffer. We say one as the TCP send buffer. The second one is TCP receive buffer, and the third one is the application layout buffer. So, because of this reason, there is a greater chance that a large variation in the jitter can be handled very effectively in case of TCP. Okay. The reason is if there is a small variation, the playout buffer will manage that one. A little higher variation that can be even supported by the TCP receiving buffer, and further if it is increased, then the sender buffer will also help at this point. And hence it is very much possible to have this kind of communication and an effective communication with the TCP. Always the TCP is known for the reliable communication, but however, every time when there is a loss of a packet or an error in the packet, is supposed to be retransmitted. When it to be retransmitted, it leads to the congestion. Congestion means the traffic of the network may be more. Whenever there is a traffic, then obviously it will be trying to manage with the buffers. So buffer, in spite of any amount of buffer, if the delay is more, obviously it will lead to the congestion. So that's the reason TCP manages the congestion by means of sawtooth technique. Okay, we say it is the sawtooth technique, and hence this sawtooth technique will really make difficult to play out the video properly. So usually the larger buffer is expected in case of TCP. I was told you, if you use the UDP, then lesser buffer is sufficient. But with the TCP and HTTP combination, you may need larger buffer, and hence larger playout delay is possible, and the smooth TCP delivery is possible with the buffer. But the other problem of UDP can be overcome with the TCP. That is, we told very clearly that the firewalls will be designed or configured to block the UDP traffic. But however, when it comes to the TCP, they will not block the traffic, and hence a smooth transition of traffic through the firewall is possible. Next, we have some of the issues with respect to the HTTP. There might be a problem where you may unable to receive some of the data at in time, and hence there are variations in the operations also, like some of the actions like a pause, forwarding, rewind are all possible in case of the video streaming. In that case, HTTP is not an effective solution. So in order to overcome these problems the buffering time and delayed jitter, all this, we use another technique called dynamic adaptive streaming over HTTP. It is shortly called as DASH, or it is been abbreviated as DASH, dynamic adaptive streaming over the HTTP. In this, the basic idea of this DASH is that You might have heard about the YouTube. I think it is the most popular technique. YouTube is a most popular technique wherein it will adopt this technique, that is Dash. What is special with Dash is it will be able to manage the variable rate. Variable rate of video is transmitted here. What do you mean by variable rate video? See, the video chunks can be delivered according to the user requirement. Chunk means a small portion of the video is called a chunk. So suppose the basic problem in any network is the inflow of the data is not constant, basically because of the traffic variation in the network. If the bandwidth is not constant, then the constant delivery of the frames or the packets is difficult. In such case, what this Dash will do with respect to the given request is, it will go on varying the rate of transmission. It will store in the server different possible bit rates. Every chunk can be transmitted with a different rate. Okay, so the rate is decided on the basis of the user's bandwidth requirement. Okay, if the user is having 10 Mbps transmission speed, which is a good transmission speed, then it will transmit the chunk with higher version. If the user is having only 5 Mbps at some point of time, it will choose the lower version of the chunk where the data transmission rate is also reduced. So the variation of the bit rate is possible, and they are pre-stored in the server. They are pre-stored in the server, and they are selected by the system automatically according to the user bandwidth at any point of time. And hence, the transmission is possible smoothly. Because of the variation in the different versions of chunk, the playback at the receiving point is very, very constant, or it will be proper. You can see here, the server divides the video file into multiple chunks, each chunk stored encoded at different rate. Rate means the bit rate. Okay, so such a file is called as manifest file. A file which has got a different rate of chunk. Okay, the URL will provide the particular file. So you will be selecting the particular file depending on the bandwidth availability. Okay, so that is possible. And if you come to the client side, in the client, you can see that it will periodically measure the server to client bandwidth, and consulting the manifest, request one chunk at a time. Okay, chooses the maximum coding rate sustainable for the given current bandwidth. It means that whatever the possible transmission in the given bandwidth, so that will be chosen from the manifest. And it can choose different coding rates at different point of time. This is another advantage. At first 5 seconds, it will be chosen a manifest of 5 Kbps. And next 5 seconds, it may have chosen the 10 Kbps manifest. Like that, the variation is adaptable. And of course, here we say that the client should have an intelligence, because client is going to make a request, and it should know what is the requirement at the client point. So the choosing of chunk is all depends on how intelligent the client is. If the client is in sufficiently intelligent and it could able to approach the server for a particular chunk with proper rate of transmission, which will really help it to make the transmission very, very properly. The first question is when to request the chunk so that the buffer, neither it will go for a starvation nor for an overflow. It means that the transmission should be smooth and buffer should not be overflown or starved. Next, what encoding rate is needed to request? An higher quality or the higher quality with the more bandwidth and lower quality with the less bandwidth? Where to request the chunk? It all, I told you very clearly, it is the manifest file. Okay, so this will maintain the different versions of the chunk. So obviously the URL should point to the specific manifest depending on the bandwidth, and hence it will be appropriately chosen. So this is all about the dash. I think we have discussed about the UDP, we discussed about the HTTP, and also dash. Dash will give almost the perfect solution for the video playout, proper playout of the video. The problems that are discussed with the UDP and HTTP are overcome in the dash, and it is the best technique. The best examples that are run with dash are YouTube. You can quote this as an example. Now we will come to another issue, which we call it as a content distribution network. Nowadays millions of videos are being accessed by the users. Okay, so much of videos will be accessed simultaneously. You believe it or not, it is the overwhelmed request by the clients to the server. And in spite of designing any server, there are situations or there are certain cases wherein the server may go to either a crash or an hanging condition. The reason for that is we don't know at what time how many users will make a request and how many videos are supposed to be delivered. So this becomes the major problem in case of the video streaming. In order to overcome this challenge, there are a few solutions are proposed. The first one is option one is the single large mega server, identifying a single large mega server. It means that it is a centralized service. It is called as a centralized service. The meaning of centralized is one large server will cater to millions of users' requests. Okay, but whenever we do centralization with a data center, by designing a data center, this will always lead to a problem of single point failure. The meaning of this is, if this server fails, then the entire system will go down and no user can access the data or videos. Okay, that's the first point. The second point is, at a single point, a greater request comes and large network request will, data packets will move, and hence it will lead to the congestion. Okay, so when it leads to the congestion, this is the greater challenge. In spite of providing any bandwidth, you'll be facing this congestion problem. And you know the consequences of congestion. Once the congestion occurs, obviously the packets loss will be more, and hence retransmission increases. Cumulatively, it leads to the total blocking of the bandwidth, and hence the delivery of data or the video to the customer is impossible. And there are other issues also, like if there is a long path distance, a distant client, it means that the client is far away from the data center. In that case, what happens, due to the long distance, there will be a different hops will be there. In a different hop, there will be an heterogeneous domains will be there. And the total transmission depends on the lowest capacity domain. So lowest capacity means the throughput of such a lowest domain, capacity domain, will lead the transmission, will decide the transmission speed. Obviously, that leads to the congestion in the network. And hence, this is another problem that has been faced by this. And also, sometimes the multiple copies of videos are sent over the outgoing link. These are some of the common issues that are happen with this one. But anyway, this can be one possible problem. The another challenge is how to stream the content to hundreds or thousands of users simultaneously. I think this can be overcome by another possibility that is basically called as content distribution network. Here, the multiple copies are stored in the different geographical places or position. It means to say that, you know, the contents can be duplicated or replicas of content will be maintained in different servers. So that we can basically avoid the possibility of making a large distance from the client. Okay, if the distance is reduced, that will basically help them to access faster, and hence the possibility of jitter will be reduced. And second important point is the delivery of video will be faster, and hence the each client can be served faster, so that server can take more and more load. In this case, what is the idea in this is there will be a different clusters are identified, okay, and these clusters are identified on the basis of the concentration of user, okay, wherever there is a larger concentration, so there will be a cluster identified, and hence a server is placed there, okay. Because of this reason, we can cater the user in a faster rate. You see, there are two possibilities. Enter deep. It's the push CDN servers deep into many access in networks. So it means that we are just finding out one server at any particular location and try to push the data to the user at the earliest. And it will be very close to the user, and that is the advantage we gain. The best example for is we call it as an ACMI technologies. You believe it or not, because of this reason, Netflix and is the best example taking this support. And also, what we say, Hulu. These two applications will take the support of ACMI. You believe it or not, more than 1,700 locations, they have maintained the servers. There is another possibility called Bring Home. A smaller number of larger clusters are identified in different POPs, and hence the access network is made easier for them. Okay, it will be used by the Limelight, and of course you can see the service how it will work here. One of the client has requested the server, and the request has gone on the either side, okay, 1 and 2. The 2 has made communication with the Net Cinema, okay, with the 3, and hence it has taken the opinion, And finally, this server will give delivery to the customer or the client. Okay. There are possibilities that it is found finally that this is also available there, then it will give the service to that. You can see that the cluster selection is the basic challenge in that case, because the user will can identify the cluster, or the server can allocate the cluster. There are two possible ways of doing this. This can be overcome with certain solutions. The first challenge, how does CDN domain name system select the good CDN node to stream the client? So the first thing is pick the CDN node geographically closest to the client. I think this is the basic rule. So client can find out who is the nearest CDN for that particular point geographically. So in that case, they can identify with respect to this client. And the second one is pick the CDN node with shortest delay. Sometimes geographically closest may not work. Rather than the shortest delay will be the better one. The reason for that is even the path is little longer, but the speed of transmission is good, or with the less congestion of traffic, shortest delay is important than the closest point. And hence, we can consider this also. The other way is IP Anycast. It will be just making the Anycast service, and it will try to find out the destination. An alternative for that is let the client take a decision. Here, we try to make the server to do all this job. Okay, rather, here we can leave that point to the client to find out the nearest CDN for that. And the client will take a decision that which CDN server is nearest to it. And it will ping the server and it will be accessing it. The best example for this is Netflix. Okay, Netflix approach will help us to find out the nearest server, and hence it could be able to make the request and get the expected video at the earliest. You can take the example of Netflix, because let us discuss Netflix as one of the case studies of our discussion. Believe it or not, Netflix has become so popular in US. In 2011 only, almost 30% downstream of US traffic is managed by the Netflix only. It will have a little infrastructure, and sometimes the third party services are also expected. A own registration and payment servers are also maintained, because you know that if you want to take the service of Netflix, you need to have the registration with the Netflix, and you have to pay for it. Then only they give the service. You believe it or not, Netflix will take the service from the Amazon cloud. This is called third party service, because Netflix itself is unable to create infrastructure all over the world to reach every user and individual user. Rather, the simple way is to take the cloud service. Amazon is one of the best infrastructured center, and hence they have taken the support of that one. The Amazon cloud is being used for Netflix, and Netflix will upload all the studio masters to the Amazon cloud, and it will create multiple versions of the movie in cloud. That why it is essential is because if the multiple copies are there in different geographical location, then the user can access easily. That is the concept of CDN. And of course, it will upload the versions from the CDN cloud. You can see here, okay. And then cloud hosts the Netflix web pages for user browsing. that the third party CDN hosts the Netflix using the examples for this are Akamai, Limelight, and Level 3. You can see this case study, how it works. Here, there is a request come from the client, okay, to this one. And then that has been forwarded to the Amazon cloud, okay. It in turn will return the manifest file. Manifest file is known to you. It is the URL only it is transmitted to this one. Because of this URL, it could be able to access. What is this URL? It is the URL of the manifest file. What is manifest file? It is the file where the expected chunk of video is available. Okay, it has been found out from these three different levels, and from there it will give this one. And once it is received the URL from the specific server, it will be accessed through this URL. So that is the idea. And hence all the technologies like dash streaming and also the CDN techniques, both have been adopted very effectively in Netflix. Because of that reason, you have a better experience with the Netflix access. With this, I wish to conclude my session of this stored video streaming. And I think it is one of the wonderful technology. And even today, there is a lot of scope for you to work on it and to understand and to come out with the new ideas so that you can really bring some changes in the technology, because nowadays, you know, there are multiple applications which are using this multimedia data. For example, if you talk about the Facebook, there also we talk about big data. We have WhatsApp and so many such social medias are there, Instagram and all. So in all these cases, the challenge is to streaming the video, okay? And this requires a lot of research and to improvise it so that we can reduce the requirement of the bandwidth, and hence the user experience can be improved. If you have any queries on this, please post to me. I'll be available at this email ID, sunilkumarvs@gmit.ac.in. So I'll be happy to answer you. Thank you. Thank you very much. In the next class, we will discuss on the voice over internet protocol.